Today, there are 2 million descendants of French-Canadian immigrants living in New England. These are our stories. Welcome to the French-Canadian Legacy Podcast.
Venez tous jeunes filles et garçons, je vais vous raconter l'histoire de notre immigration ici aux USA, de grands aventuriers des pays étrangers.
This is the French-Canadian Legacy Podcast. I am Jesse Martineau. And for those that may not know, June 24th is the Fête Nationale du Québec, the Quebec national holiday known to many as Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day. This is a really big deal in Quebec, and it remains a really big deal for those immigrants who came from Quebec and settled in New England. And to help us explore the history and significance of Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day, we have again requested the assistance of the French-Canadian Legacy's favorite Englishman, James Mile. And for those, most of you will remember that James is a return guest to the podcast. James spent 4 years as the coordinator of Franco-American Collections at the University of Southern Maine. He co-authored the book Franco-Americans of Lewiston, Auburn. He runs a really great blog, Parlez-vous American, and he was all over the excellent documentary, The Home Road, which everyone needs to check out. So, James, welcome back to the French-Canadian Legacy Podcast.
Thanks for having me back, guys.
Now, James, I think most people know the story of how St. Patrick's Day became a big deal to the Irish, but I'm not sure it is very well known why St. Jean-Baptiste Day became a big deal to the French Canadians. So we kind of like to start with the origin. Where does Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day originally come from?
Yeah, so it's a pretty old holiday. It seems to have its roots kind of actually in, you know, the earliest parts of what we would think of as French history and culture. So back in, you know, the early, probably goes back to sort of some pre-Christian Celtic rituals. And, you know, because it's celebrated on June the 24th, it's very close to the summer solstice and probably incorporates, you know, some of those traditions from that period, just in the same way that, you know, we think there are, you know, in our modern Easter traditions, there are some of those Celtic pagan roots, and in our Christmas traditions, there are probably some of those mixed up in the Saint-Jean-Baptiste traditions as well. Certainly celebrated in France long before the French came to Canada. And some of those early French colonists came, when they came, they brought the Saint-Jean-Baptiste celebrations with them. Pretty early on in the, from the early 1600s are some of those first mentions of Saint-Jean-Baptiste being celebrated in New France and what became Canada.
Cool. So is it one of these issues of there's kind of like a pagan celebration, all of a sudden we have this Christianity thing moving in. Let's kind of almost meld the two together. We take what was a pagan celebration, and now all of a sudden we assign it to a saint. And now we have a summer holiday called Saint-Jean-Baptiste.
Yeah, I mean, there's almost certainly like some of that going on, I think, in like melding the two traditions together. And I think that's one of the reasons why, I mean, it's a little, one of the things that's kind of interesting is sort of how it caught on in French Canada, particularly. You know, it was, I think it was a pretty big celebration in some of the parts of France that the bulk of the colonists came from. So some of the early settlers of Canada, a lot of them came either from Brittany or from Normandy, and those parts of sort of northwest France, which is where it seems like Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day was particularly significant. And so that may be one reason. I mean, officially, the first patron saint of Canada was supposed to be Saint Joseph. Saint Joseph's Day is a different day, which I don't even know because it's not widely celebrated among French Canadians, but that is a separate holiday. And, you know, the patron saint of France at the time was, I believe, was Saint Denis. Much later on becomes Saint Joan of Arc. But yeah, so Saint-Jean-Baptiste was not particularly supposed to be the patron saint of Canada or of the French at the time, did become, for whatever reason, sort of became adopted by French Canadians. And it may be because, you know, this was a pretty big holiday in those local areas of France where a lot of the early settlers came from.
Very cool. Now, what would a normal celebration day look like, especially early on in New France? Like, I'm assuming we're going to church. What other kind of things have happened on an early Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day?
Yeah. So obviously there's kind of there is a religious element to it, and it's probably a particular church service and a mass. But, you know, some of the other things we see mentioned are a bonfire is often a big part of it. And there are some mentions about, I think in some of the earliest recordings in the Jesuit histories about the first Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day celebrations, they talk about, you know, firing cannons and that sort of thing to celebrate it. You know, folks might have had a special meal, something like that. And it may have been a day off from work from a lot of folks as well. There's some early accounts of even the early French explorers when they were sailing off the coast of what we now know as Newfoundland, you know, they took a break for Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day. So in many you know, kind of in this early colonial period, these days are often marked by the fact that it was a day off from work, particularly.
Gotcha. Okay, now we hear that it kind of took on, it started anyway, taking on more political significance in 1834. And why is that year important? What's going on? What changed kind of the tenor of the holiday?
Yeah, so that's kind of where we see sort of the first modern Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day celebration. So in 1834, there's an organization founded in Quebec, the province that was then known as Lower Canada, but in what we would now think of as Quebec, called the Association Saint-Jean-Baptiste, the St. John the Baptist Society. That was founded in 1834, and they pretty quickly designated June 24th to be, they took advantage of kind of the popularity of the Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day celebration and put on sort of a an event that would be a celebration of French Canadian history and culture. And so it was kind of a, it was a way of sort of launching their own organization, but also tying it into this sense of French Canadian identity and history. And I think a big part of it is, you know, a big part of the context here is that, you know, this is a time of sort of particularly growing awareness among French Canadians living in Canada. Obviously by 1834, we're in this period where it's been under British rule for a number of decades, for a couple of generations. And it's only a few years after that that we see in 1837 the outbreak of this rebellion in Lower Canada and that's sometimes called the Patriot Uprising, for folks who are pushing for more representation for French Canadians in the government, and even some folks who are pushing for sort of an independent province. So it's a time of sort of rising nationalism and national identity among French Canadians, and Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day and the Saint-Jean-Baptiste Society are sort of at the center of that.
And one thing I read someplace, I wonder if you could comment on, which I thought it was kind of fascinating, that almost another motive for the day taking on kind of almost what it became later on, almost the modern appearance, was the fact that all these Irish were now moving in to Montreal. And they had their St. Patrick's Day, they had their parade. So now these French Canadian nationalists are like, hey, we need our parade too. Let's have a St. Jean-Baptiste Day.
Yeah. And this is, you know, this is a period in which, like, there's a growing amount of Irish immigration to Quebec as well. So, yeah, you're right. They're being exposed to this. And that's part of the, you know, the main organizer of the Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day was a man named Ludger Duvernay. And he was a newspaper publisher and sort of a thought leader in some of these early nationalist movements. But yeah, he's said to have attended a St. Patrick's Day parade in the years before and sort of taken his inspiration from that. So yeah, they share a number of characteristics in terms of the parades and the marches and things that are part of each celebration.
Yeah. And what do these parades look like? Like, who's marching in these parades?
As they grow in size, you see sort of it's an opportunity for a lot of the French Canadian societies to get together, sort of to have these parades that are not that dissimilar from what we'd think of, like I say, for a St. Patrick's Day parade, or, you know, even like a 4th of July or Memorial Day parade in the United States. There are often marching bands, banners, people will be sort of singing or chanting. They will often have sort of slogans on their banners and placards. So sometimes, you know, and sometimes these things have a more political nature, as we were just sort of talking about. And so they're, you know, and often, especially in these early ones in Canada, there might be political speeches and that sort of thing. But they're often, you know, when you see them, especially when they come to New England, they're often a chance for sort of different societies to come together and sort of show the unity of the French Canadian community, and to sort of parade through both the French Canadian sort of part of town, but also, you know, the whole city, and sort of show, you know, the strength of the community and the different institutions that they have.
Sure. One thing I think is kind of a fun little sidebar I was reading about, that these parades often featured a curly haired child with a sheep, which is always important. You have to depict Saint John the Baptist as a curly haired child with a sheep.
The child is chosen to represent the young Saint John the Baptist, who, you know, in the biblical tradition is, you know, one of the things he's most famous for is his discovery of, you know, the young Jesus as a boy, and sort of paving the way for Jesus's arrival. And so the young curly haired child, blonde curly haired child, usually is sort of represents a young Saint John the Baptist, and the sheep represents kind of the Lamb of God that he's, I think in one of the Gospels is specifically, you know, that wording is used.
Sure.
He's telling people about the Lamb of God. So that's usually what was chosen. And you can see that, you know, in a lot of these, you know, when I worked at the Franco-American collection, we would have a whole series of different curly haired boys through the years. And some of them were repeat people and some of them were one-offs, but and, you know, after a while, one of the things that I liked there was, you know, after a while, you could see how the tradition changed when, you know, there were fewer farms around, probably, and that sort of thing. You know, they would have a different lamb every year for a while, and then at one point, somebody came out with the idea of just sort of taxidermying the sheep they already had and just carrying that around with them. So in my office at the collection there, I used to be very close to this stuffed sheep that was looking at me. It had been on the parade, so yeah.
That's hilarious. All right, there was another shift I want to mention before we really get into how we're celebrating New England, because we talked about the shift in, you know, the 1834, but it seems like there's another shift in how it was celebrated in Quebec in the 1960s, 70s. Mm. And there's a shift in everything in Quebec in the 1960s, 70s.
Right.
And it seems like how Saint Jean-Baptiste was celebrated is clearly among those changes.
Holiday had always been kind of celebrated with this connection to you know, French Canadian identity and nationalism, but as you say, sort of in the 60s and 70s, is, you know, kind of wrapped up as part of the Quiet Revolution in Quebec. The holiday is kind of secularized in a lot of ways, so it becomes less about sort of the religious element to it. You know, it had been very tightly wrapped up with the church, as with a lot of things in Quebec. And so it becomes much more focused on sort of culture and art and the history, and becomes, they really sort of branding it as a national holiday. And so it's very much in line with the separatist movement, and this idea of it not just being about sort of the French-Canadian culture as a people, but as a nation and as a potential, you know, future independent nation. So it becomes rebranded as the Fête Nationale. So it's not even officially known as St. John the Baptist Day anymore, although it is kind of, it maintains a lot of the traditions. So it becomes known as the Fête Nationale, the national holiday. And the celebration of it is publicly supported and publicly funded by the province of Quebec, I believe, still. And it's a pretty big deal.
That's cool. And I'm going to imagine that it may have, because you mentioned the separatist movement, I wonder, did it play a little bit of a role anyway, 1980, 1995, those kind of referendums?
Yeah, I don't know. That's a good question. I know there were certain, you know, certainly some of the politicians, it was, you know, it's an event where I think some of the politicians have been involved in that, and some of the big moments of, you know, creating French Canadian identity in modern times have been put up with that. I don't know if there's particular connections with the independence movement, but there may well be.
Gotcha. All right. So moving down then to New England, when do we start seeing Saint Jean-Baptiste parades, festivals in the New England area?
More or less sort of as soon as you get large numbers of French Canadians in these periods, in these towns in this period. So, you know, as we said, the idea has sort of popped up and been established in 1834, continues through the 1840s and 50s. And then you start to see, you know, you see some early French Canadians in New England, even, you know, even in the 1830s and 40s, but you really start seeing more and more folks arriving in the 1870s. And so that's when you actually start seeing these Saint Jean-Baptiste Day celebrations in the United States as well. So, you know, in the city of Lewiston, Maine, which is the one that I'm most familiar with, the Saint Jean-Baptiste Society, and then what actually becomes the dominant French-Canadian organization in the city, the Institut Jacques Cartier, is founded in 1872. They put on a Saint Jean-Baptiste Day celebration that year, and sort of every year for a number of years thereafter. So you really start seeing it in those 1870s, and you see that in other towns across New England. They're all sort of, and some of these are linked together, you know, the leaders in these communities are communicating with each other. They're sort of reading similar newspapers, keeping in touch with other societies in Quebec. And a lot of these Saint Jean-Baptiste societies are part of a network. And so they are sort of you know, in some ways coordinating and drawing ideas from each other. But you see them in Massachusetts and Connecticut, Rhode Island, all in the same, New Hampshire, all in Vermont, all in the same period in those 1870s, and popping up through the 1880s and 1890s.
One of the organizations you mentioned is something that came up a number of times when I was reading kind of the history of the holiday in New England, the Institut Jacques Cartier. Mm-hmm. Just give us just some background. What was that organization about?
So Lewiston is a little unusual in that the main organization is this Institut Jacques Cartier. In many towns in New England, they would have their own Société Saint-Jean-Baptiste.
Right.
Apparently, one of the stories is that in Lewiston, there were two different groups. There was the Institut Jacques Cartier, and there was a Société Saint-Jean-Baptiste, and they actually merged pretty early on because they were trying to do the same thing.
Sure.
And the reason they kept the Jacques Cartier name was because that was a group that already had their flags and banners printed up, and it's easier than doing new ones. So, which is quite a practical reason.
Oh,
so
absolutely.
I believe that in Lewiston, the Institut Jacques Cartier got its start partly from trying to raise funds for the new Franco-American parish church in the city. There already was a Catholic church, but it was there were a lot of Irish parishioners there, and there were enough French Canadians that they wanted their own church. And so the Jacques Cartier Society was formed to sort of help raise donations for that. Even from the beginning, had this initial sort of association with the local parish, but it was largely sort of, it was also largely independent from the parish, even though it coordinated activities with them. And a lot of the members were sort of some of the leading, what you might think of as like the professional men in the Franco-American community. So the folks who happened to be lawyers and doctors, eventually the newspaper publishers and things. So, and that was kind of typical. You would see these folks who would be, more likely to be college educated, a little more middle class. They're often the folks who are leading these societies and sort of helping to, they saw it as part of their role, I think, to help support sort of the Franco-American identity when they're in this new country and sort of help make sure that those traditions and that culture was maintained.
I'm curious, when this first got going, the 1860s, 1870s, was it primarily a religious holiday here in New England, or did it take on meaning for the survivance? Did it have a political tinge right from the jump here in New England?
I think it's always had a little bit of a political tinge with that survivance maintenance of culture and heritage, partly because that is also connected with the religious element in New England. The parish is kind of the main, one of the main pillars and institutions that helps to maintain that identity. And, the fact that the Jacques Cartier Society in Lewiston was founded to help raise funds for the church kind of tells you that the two are sort of connected, right? The folks who found the society see that as part of keeping the French Canadian identity. So they have their own parish with their own institutions and their own language and maintaining their own community. So it was definitely it's hard to sort of disentangle the two. I mean, I think these events are largely, they're not, although there's a religious aspect to it all the time, and you see this with other parades and events in the community too, there's usually sort of an open air mass and a blessing of the parade before it sets out. There's often often the clergy kind of play a role in some of the preparations, but largely they're sort of organized by these outside and slightly separate societies. So they're sort of connected from and not entirely separate from the church, but they're also like not just church sponsored.
Sure. Yeah, that makes sense. And one of the things that struck me when I was getting ready for this interview was just the scale of these celebrations.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about, shipping in thousands of people to mm-hmm. attend. I mean, the one in Nashua was in 1888, 9,000 men marching mm-hmm. in this parade. And every town you could possibly think of that had, seemingly anybody that had more than three French Canadians in their town is having a parade. Like tons of towns all over the place did this. It was crazy.
Most towns are trying to have some kind of celebration among the local community. I mean, I think one of the things that you see is really fun is that the cooperation between communities too. So sometimes when you see those really big parades, like the 9,000 folks in Nashua, that's partly the result of a whole bunch of, it's also when they're holding a French Canadian convention there. And so, there are even some folks coming down from Canada and folks from other states and neighboring towns. And so you see that, when I've been doing my research on sort of what's been happening, the Messager in 1894 project that I told you guys about before. Yeah. You know, one of the things that you can, one of the things they're talking about there is about how this year they're going to have a big celebration in Brunswick instead of in Lewiston, and they're inviting these other societies to go to Brunswick and participate in their parade. So, you know, they're coordinating even between sort of neighboring communities and sort of having bigger parades by sort of pooling their resources, which is kind of fun. So again, it's not just about like the clubs in, you know, Lewiston putting on a show. It's about having folks from neighboring communities sort of contributing to them as well and rotating between those in different years.
That's awesome. You'll probably learn a lesson from that among French Canadian organizations today, I think.
I mean, that's true. Yeah, I think one of their purposes was to show that, you know, the bigger and more impressive the parade, the more it kind of sent a message, I think, to this implicit message to like the English speaking community of, you know, we're here and we're a significant community and, you know, you should be paying attention to our needs and interests as well.
That's cool. And one of the things you note in one of your articles is that a lot of the businesses shut down for the day.
Yeah.
And that seems kind of crazy to me. We're at a time you hear like the mills never shut down.
Mm-hmm,
like,
mm-hmm.
We don't have the holidays like we have now. The mill's got to keep working because the mills aren't working. The mill boss doesn't make money. But on that day, it was a shutdown.
Yeah, I think it's pretty. You're right. It is pretty remarkable. I think you know, when you look at, you know, I've done some other research on sort of when Franco-Americans trying to make New Year's Day a holiday, and which wasn't particularly celebrated among the Puritans of New England, and it's kind of a similar story there. You know, the factory owners and the mill bosses, you know, didn't want to have to shut down, and you know, typically they had multiple shifts, so they just kept running the machinery, you know, 24 hours a day. But you know, what you see is these Franco-Americans just walking off the job and don't turn up, and so eventually they just sort of have to give in because their workforce is so predominantly Franco-American that if they can't find anyone to work on Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day, they may as well close the place down. And yeah, you know, I think that's the kind of tactic that's especially effective in the boom eras. You know, there are some times which are particularly hard and places are closing or laying people off because there isn't enough work when there's a depression or something.
Sure.
When there isn't, and when the mills are booming, what you see is that there's an interesting power dynamic because they need workers so much that, like, even if, you know, if you don't show up for work, especially when a whole bunch of you don't show up for Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day, you know, if the boss fires you, then you just go to the mill next door and can pick up the same job for a similar pay. So it is interesting that even though the working conditions are really terrible in all of these places, you know, the workers also have a certain amount of power in some respect when their labor is in demand.
Oh, that's awesome. Again, this is a story you don't hear very often from that period. And another thing that I thought was pretty fascinating in one of your articles, you mentioned that it wasn't just Franco-Americans who showed up for these parades. And I guess it's got to be semi-similar to how it's not just Irish who show up for St. Patrick's Day parades now. But lots of people showed up for these parades, which I think is real cool from my perspective, because all we hear is how terribly all these French Canadians were treated when they arrived. But now they're having their festival, and all of a sudden we have non-French who are showing up to watch.
Yeah, I think that's, you know, another motivation for having these big celebrations. It's sort of, it becomes like a community event, and it's like, you know, just in the same way that like everyone turns out for the 4th of July parade, they turn out a couple of weeks earlier for the Saint-Jean-Baptiste Day parade. And they make an effort, I think, to, especially once these parades get going, that they're not just parading in Little Canada areas. They're going into the, you know, the main streets and the English part of town and sort of, you know, showing off their presence, but also, you know, it's providing entertainment for those folks. So you see sometimes, you know, depending on the parade and the era, you see, you know, it's not just French societies that are invited to participate. You see sometimes there are Irish societies taking part in sort
That's
of a
awesome.
Show of solidarity. You know, you're also sometimes seeing even just some general sort of civic organizations and things like that. So I think it's, you know, and especially in some towns like Lewiston, these people just start looking forward to these events, and it's just really fun. So everyone likes a good parade, I think.
Yeah, you don't need an excuse to party. I like that. That's cool. Another thing that caught my attention is there were a number of references to French from France in some of these parades. Patrick Lacroix noted that in Lowell Celebration 1873, there was a banner with Liberté, Égalité, Fraternité. In the Fall River 1883, they were flying the French tricolor. There was Manchester portraits of Napoleon being displayed through these parades. And I thought that was interesting because all of that French history happened well after the French Canadian ancestors were already in New France. So I thought that was kind of cool to have that tie back to France.
It is pretty interesting. And you see that in some of the, you know, the, definitely the use of the French tricolour you see all over the place. I mean, so, you know, I think part of that is because there are sort of limited numbers of like French Canadian symbols that they're using. So, you know, there isn't like, you know, the fleur-de-lis flag that we now associate with Quebec hasn't been adopted in this period. So they don't have like a French Canadian flag in there.
Right. Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, there's not even a Canadian flag yet, so they're not going to be, you know, they're unlikely to be using the Union Jack, the British Union Jack. So, like, the French tricolour is sort of, it partly represents their French heritage, and so that's part of that. Well, there are two things. I think there's this kind of a conscious attempt in some ways to sort of brand themselves a little bit with some of these French things that are probably familiar to Americans. So I think there's probably kind of like a savvy sort of thing going on there. I think there's also a genuine, even though, you know, the culture of French Canada is, you know, pretty different and diverges from the culture of metropolitan France, you know, significantly in some ways. I think there is sort of some affinity for that and some connectedness with that, especially among, you know, some of the folks who are organizing these parades, are the doctors and lawyers, and, you know, the folks who are, you know, potentially more likely to be college educated and are more likely to be sort of reading novels and things. You know, you see some of these same folks are organizing musical events and theatrical societies, and like the plays that those folks are putting on in these New England cities are mostly plays that were written in France in the 1800s, not French Canadian works. So they're definitely sort of adopting elements of sort of metropolitan French culture as part of their, you know, signifying their Frenchness as well. I'm not sure how much of that sort of trickles down to sort of the everyday folks, who are probably more likely to be familiar with the, you know, the folk tales of Quebec and the traditional songs than they are, you know, new books and plays and things that are coming out of France. But there is a little bit of a merging of those two things in this period.
Okay. And one other thing I wanted to touch on, as far as flags that you see at these parades, you read almost always, there's also a lot of American flags flying through, and you got pictures of George Washington. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm assuming that's a message too, right? Hey, we're down with Team USA as well.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, they are really sort of hyper aware of this. I mean, I think we've talked before and you've had other guests who have spoken really eloquently of sort of the discrimination that French Canadians face. And so they're really keen to show that, like, yes, they're immigrants and yes, they're proud of their culture, but they're also really proud of being Americans as well. And so they're really emphasizing both the French and the American and Franco-American. So every time, you know, if you look at these photographs of these parades and things, almost every time you see a French tricolour, you see American stars and stripes alongside it. And they're really trying to say that, you know, these can both be true at the same time. You know, we're not going to give up our French culture and heritage, but that doesn't make us any less American as well. And so, you know, the one quote that I liked that was from an account of the parade in Lewiston said, this was Louis Martel, who was a doctor and one of the leaders of the Institut Jacques Cartier. He said, "We French Canadians love the traditions and the tongue of old France, but we are true Americans and we love America best." So that's awesome. Sort of encapsulates a lot of that. And the motto of the Institut Jacques Cartier was "Loyal mais Canadien Français," so loyal but French Canadian. So again, saying we still think of ourselves as French Canadian, but we're loyal Americans too.
Oh, that's cool. Now, when do we start seeing like these parades start dying out? Like, how long do these giant parades and giant festivals last? Because obviously they're not around anymore.
Right. Yeah, and there are some places where they still have sort of some Saint-Jean-Baptiste celebrations, but they're certainly, I don't think they're any on the scale that they were. I mean, I think you sort of see them petering out a little more sort of as we get into the later part of the 20th century. So like 1970s, 1980s. I think, you know, in Lewiston, they continued for a really long time, but you see them sort of getting smaller and moving to smaller venues as the years go on. I think sort of trying to think about like why that is, it's kind of interesting. I think you see, this a little bit in sort of all cultures in the US in this period, that there's just like a little less of this like civic community culture that we might think of, you know, where folks do belong to like three or four different societies and take part in parades and things, whereas folks are a little more, just culture in general is changing, where people are more likely to be, you know, like watching television instead of like going out watching parades, or they're more likely to be, you know, moving from town to town every few years rather than growing up and staying in the same town for generations. But I think those are also sort of particularly influential on immigrant communities like the Franco-American community. So, you know, folks aren't all packed into the same neighborhoods anymore. They're not necessarily, you know, staying and raising a family where they were born. They might be moving to other places. They're not sort of in the same world of sort of exclusively French spoken literature and entertainment. So, you know, they're not just listening to the traditional French music in kitchen parties that they might have been in the 1800s. You know, they're now listening to English language radio and television. And so I think there's a bit of an erosion of sort of Franco-American community in general in that period. And then I think you've got maybe more or just as significantly, you've just got this general propensity for like less community spirit and organizing that you see across the country in this period too.
Yeah, I mean, in one of your articles, I think you asked the question, which I think is fascinating. I've been thinking about it since I read it. Why do we still have St. Patrick's Day parade? So we got a St. Patrick's Day parade in Manchester still. Day. We still in Manchester, we still have a St. Jean-Baptiste celebration through the Franco-American Center, but we don't have a parade anymore. Every year you have the giant shamrocks painted on the Elm Street. We got the Irish flags hanging from the poles. So that celebration survived in Manchester, but St. Jean-Baptiste did not, at least to that scale.
It is a really interesting parallel because, you know, in some ways the histories of them are very similar. And as we've said, you know, the Saint Jean-Baptiste is already drawing on some of the traditions in the earliest period from St. Patrick's Day. But like St. Patrick's Day sort of survives and grows and flourishes, whereas Saint Jean-Baptiste Day sort of dies out a little more. I mean, I think there are a couple of things that come to mind. Like one is, what is maybe sort of the straightforward explanation, or in some ways, which is maybe that, you know, I think St. Patrick's Day has the advantage that it really took off and became, it was cemented in cities like Boston and New York and Chicago. Sure. That became like really major celebrations and very high profile. And in those areas, you had Irish Americans sort of, you had these machine politics, and Irish Americans basically ran City Hall in those cities. And the St. Patrick's Day was kind of like, it was a really important place for politicians to sort of prove themselves and show up. And so it became like a really huge part of the community and a cornerstone of the community, in the way that there wasn't, you know, you did see sort of French Canadians becoming more involved in the power structures in places like Lewiston or Manchester or Woonsocket, but you didn't see them not in sort of the really large cities like that, where the celebration, where St. Patrick's Day could spread out to be a national holiday, you know, with the Macy's Day parade and things.
Sure.
So I think that probably, you know, I think that kind of thing probably helped. But I think, you know, there may also just be another bit that is like less, harder to put your finger on, but I think maybe it's just the difference between sort of the Irish community that were able to sort of assimilate and pass into sort of being sort of good immigrants, or pass into sort of the wider American story more easily because they were English speaking.
Sure.
And so I think, you know, there's also some of that, whereas like Irish immigrants were sort of seen as being sort of good immigrants or acceptable immigrants like earlier than French Canadians might have been. And so I think there's probably some of that as well. It was easier for English speaking folks and the sort of older stock Yankee population to get on board with St. Patrick's Day than it was for them to sort of try and take part or get on board with Saint Jean-Baptiste Day.
Okay, this is cool. Last question for me. I know in Manchester, or at least Southern New Hampshire, we still celebrate St. Jean-Baptiste, always have. Now it's kind of been merged into the giant Poutinfest festival. That is, we always have that weekend, which is a huge event for us. What does St. Jean-Baptiste look like in Lewiston, Maine, in that area now? Is there anything still being done?
So there have been some attempts kind of recently in Lewiston specifically. So, you know, I think the actual sort of the parade and the more sort of the more traditional activities did sort of wind up and just sort of finish probably in the 1990s, might have been the last time that was happening. But there have been some attempts to have sort of events on that day, both at the Franco-American Collection where I used to work, and then at the Franco-American Center there in downtown Lewiston. And so folks have been doing some things there, and that's often involves like a little bit of a musical celebration, stuff like that. There's also a festival in Biddeford called La Comesa. And the date of that has changed sometimes. I think, and they have been doing that in June, and I think they're. I think this year it's going to be in June as well. So that kind of has some of those elements of a Saint Jean Baptiste Day, even though it's not called that. So that's a big French Canadian festival in Biddeford, Maine. So there have been a few different places that have done things on and around Saint Jean Baptiste, even if it's not sort of in quite the same tradition as it had been, 50 years ago.
Sure. Well, thank you very much. There is no way I could have had a podcast called The French Canadian Legacy without an episode dedicated to Saint Jean Baptiste Day. So James Mile, again, check out his work, Parlez-vous Américain. He's an awesome blogger. He does a ton of work. James, thank you again for joining us for the second time. This is very cool.
Thanks, Jesse. Happy to do it.
Now our fathers look at us and sigh with despair to think that everything they love we simply do not share. But the spirit never dies, our culture will survive. Each of us must choose how much to keep alive. Each of us must choose how much to keep alive.
Special thanks to Josie Vachon for providing the music. You can find more about her at josievachon.com. This podcast was produced and edited by Mike Campbell. If you have any questions or comments, please email us at fclpodcast@gmail.com. You can also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at fclpodcast for more information about the topics discussed. If you enjoyed the show, please subscribe and leave us a review on iTunes or wherever you listen to this episode.
This program is recorded at the Concord TV Podcasting Studio. The views and opinions expressed during this podcast are not necessarily those of Concord TV. The producer is solely responsible for its content.